Okay, so I was about to start the OSI coordinator. Sorry for this is to take a long session. So I just want to just give me some more time just to we'll wrap up. I'll discuss about that use case, then we'll wrap up. We'll do the hands-on tomorrow. Okay, so OSI coordinator, basically again, if you want to define a workflow, you need to define in terms of job dot properties where you specify your key value pairs about your the metadata for which is used for your job, right? The workflow. Similarly, in coordinator, you have a coordinator dot properties where you can go and define your the metadata like your name node, job tracker, and all this information, right? The folder where you are going to have your coordinator, and you see there is a path. Okay, so there is a one more property, like for workflow we add a workflow app dot path. If you notice here, so you need to specify OSI dot WF dot application path. Here you need to specify where your workflow is located. Similarly, in coordinator dot properties, you have to specify the OSI dot quad dot, which is nothing but coordinator dot application dot path. Here you have to specify the coordinator where your coordinator dot XML is placed. That path you need to specify. Okay. So then, so basically, what coordinator is going to run your workflow. So then you have to specify the path of your workflow, okay, which is I kept it in the OSI example dot WF, and this input path I'm going to use it in a workflow. So basically this job dot the coordinator dot properties going to have information which need to be supplied for your coordinator, and also information it's going to have the information which is going to be supplied for the workflow it is going to call. So both the information has to be available on this coordinator dot properties. Okay, so then you have to specify what time it has to start. So it has to be specified in this format: date, then T as a delimiter, and followed by your time. Okay, so the workflows can be start in a minute. Okay, so at 2 a.m. at 4:45 it has to start, and you have to just have this Z as well. So basically what time it has to start, basically your timestamp where it has to, when it has to start, and you have to specify the end also. Like this will be you will give a future date. If it is going to run for longer period, you can give whatever the future period you want to specify. And then you are going to capture the frequency. So if you want to run for every 5 minutes, this is just a definition. So we are going to use it in the coordinator.xml, just capturing the value. So if you want to run for 5 minutes, I'm declaring a variable called frequency underscore minute. I'm saving that value as 5. And the time zone, what time zone this workflow, because time zone is very important. So which time zone this job has to be run and triggered. That is you captured in the coordinator dot properties. So next, coordinator dot XML is going to be simple. So it is going to have like workflow app tag as a first tag. Coordinator dot XML is going to have a coordinator app as a first tag. And it is going to have your start time, and it is going to have end time, which you defined here. You're going to use it here. And frequency definition will be a little different. So you need to specify your, this is just to capture number. I want to take that number, and whether it is the frequency is minutes, 5 minutes or 5 hours, you have to specify here. So quad colon minutes. So there is, good documentation. So here, function specification. So there is a big section which talks about frequency. So we can schedule your workflow in a coordinator in terms of minutes, interval in a minutes or hours or days or months, or you can also specify the cron expression. So based on that it actually runs. So that's what you are mentioning in the frequency and name of the coordinator. Just a minute. Okay, so basically like workflow name can be defined using the what is it, name properties. Similarly, coordinator name also you can define using the name property. So basically start and end and the time zone, frequency, these are the very important when you define a coordinator app. Then it is going to have an action and which will call the workflow, and you have to specify the application path of your workflow. So this is what you define in coordinator. So when the coordinator is going to when WSI server is going to run this coordinator, so it is going to run on this time and on the start time you specified, and it is going to run for every frequency specified here. So again, to submit your coordinator to the WSI server, again you have a command, the same command. So you just have to change the property file. So WSI job, the option is hyphen WSI URL hyphen conf. Here you need to specify the coordinator dot properties and hyphen run. Okay, so this is how we can run your WSI coordinator. Okay, so which will run it. Okay, now coming back to, okay, so just want to check with you, are you okay? Can I continue or do you want to see running of your sample workflows and coordinators in the next session, or can I continue? What is do you want to continue in the same session today? Do you want to continue today's session more time, or it's fine? We can do it in next class. Hello, can you hear me?
Yes, Pari.
So do you want to continue the running these examples now, or you want to do it in the next class?
We can do it in next class.
I think, yeah, it would be better if we do it like next class.
Okay, all right, fine. So before we wrap up, okay, so I will explain you 2 more minutes about the use case which I was talking about. Just to keep it mind. Just keep it in your mind and just think over it. We will discuss anyway once we run this example as well. So this is the use case I was thinking to develop. Okay, so basically you can just give a heading as sales analysis. Sales analysis using not both. Okay, so basically we are going to analyze the sales in sales data. Okay, so basically if you run a e-commerce company, okay, or any retail related company, so you get a sales information whenever people purchase. So it can, the sales information can come from any e-commerce website or the sale is happening on individual stores. Okay, so if you want to take the data and if you want to process in the Hadoop system, how you can actually build the system. So that's what we are going to do. Okay, so you can think of as a sales data is available in a RDBMS system, and also the so basically you can think in the sales data what you will have basically customer information and the product information, and basically whenever the sale happen on particular product which is purchased by particular customer, then you will have that information, right? So think as a in RDBMS you have a customer and product information, and you can think there is a website. Okay, so you can think there is a website, e-commerce website, or one, or it can be many. It can be a e-commerce website like Flipkart or Amazon, or can be a data coming from retail stores. Okay, so whenever the sale happens on either e-commerce website or sales store, they are going to send your data in terms of files. So the sales information is going to be sent as a files. Okay, so that is the use case. Okay, so your the customer and product information is going to be in your RDBMS system, and your sales data will be coming to as a files to you in your one of the Linux server. Okay, so how do you pick it? So how do you pick this information and process on the Hadoop? So that's a high level problem statement, or the use case statement. Okay, so just how we can actually use this information, how we can build a system and integrated. Just doing it in individual components is not important. How do you integrate with different components, and then how do you run those jobs in a scheduler is going to be your learning learning path actually. So that will give you the better understanding about how to use Hadoop related components or Hadoop ecosystem components. This use case is clear, right? So basically you want to process your retail data, okay, the retail data or sales data in Hadoop using different components. So everything should be automated. Okay, so okay, at least most of the things has to be automated, so that it actually picks the data and process and provides the report. Okay, so once the report is the reports data is available, we will show it in some dashboard. The dashboard part, probably if you are familiar creating a dashboards, that's well and good, or else I can actually help you creating a dashboard as well. But the use case is clear. Are you have any question on the use case? Is the use case, can you hear me? Is the use case is clear for everyone?
Yes, Pari.
Okay, all right.
Yeah.
Okay, so yeah, so with that, we can wrap up today's class, and we'll see. Tomorrow we'll actually, I will walk you through, I will run those example. So I'm going to run it on my VM, which is the Cloudera VM. I have some issue setting up that Uzi on the Apache Uzi on the VM which I was using it. Okay, so there is some version compatibility. I have to set up again my Uzi. Okay, so what I'm trying to use, I'm trying to use the Cloudera Quick Start VM. You can actually in a Cloudera website. Currently, they are not providing this VM, so that's why there is some forums, Cloudera forums, where they specified that the VM location. That's what I shared in the groups. So if you already have, fine. So if you need it, you can take from that link. Okay. Okay. So we'll be using for this use case setup on the Cloudera VM. Okay. So. If you have any question, I can take up, or we can wind off.
You're good, Pari.
Okay, all right. Thank you so much. See you in the tomorrow session. Yeah. Okay.
Yeah, sure, Pari.
Thanks. Pari, can you just stay for a few minutes?
Yeah. Others can. Drop off.
Can you allow me to share?
Yeah, I'm just making this. I will stop the recording, okay?
Yeah, sure.